हेलो कोडर्स, वी आर मीटिंग आफ्टर अ गैप। होप ऑल ऑफ यू आर डूइंग गुड। सो हियर टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस हाउ वी कैन यूज डाटाबेस ऑफ माई एस क्यू एल इन ए स्प्रिंग बूट माइक्रो सर्विस। हियर यू कैन सी द आउटपुट और रेस्पॉन्स ऑफ ए स्प्रिंग माइक्रो सर्विस विच प्रोवाइड्स ए पीस ऑफ जेसन। दैट जेसन कंटेन्स अन आरे, दैट आरे कंटेन्स नेम ऑफ कंट्रीज विच आर फ्रॉम ए टेबल प्रेजेंट इन अ डाटाबेस ऑफ माई एस क्यू एल। सो मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम वी विल हैव द रिक्वायरमेंट टू गेट द रेस्पॉन्स ऑफ ए माइक्रो सर्विस इन दिस फॉर्मैट सो दैट अदर माइक्रो सर्विसेस कैन गो फॉर यूजिंग इट। This response will be provided by the microservice and another microservice or maybe another client will go for using it by hitting the API which we have created. So this piece of data comes from MySQL database which I have installed in my machine and I have set up also the database. The database contains the table. When we will go for using the database, I will show you how to use it. But from which place this data comes, let me show you. Here is the MySQL workbench. In this MySQL workbench, I have a database or schema. The schema contains a table called as country. The country has these records. There are six records which contains the country name: India, USA, Russia, Nepal, UK, France. So accordingly, you are getting six set of records also in this response. If I will go for adding a new country, suppose let's say Italy, and I'll apply it. So now if I will refresh this microservice or this API, so here you can see Italy also got added. That is how our microservice work with the database to provide the response. We will see how we can do it. For that, what is the requirement? That we will see first. For this, we need to have MySQL database in our machine. For MySQL, there are different sources from where you can get it. But a most popular one is the mysql.com. where you can find the downloads, the community downloads. Here is the link. That link also I will put in the description box. There you can download. And after downloading it, you will install. There is nothing special in the installation. You can keep on clicking on next, 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 next. Then you need to provide your password and you need to start your MySQL on startup of the window. That information you have to supply. The rest are very simple. Next, you can start the MySQL by going into this Windows service, or else if you have already given the command for starting the MySQL in Windows startup, then nothing required. You just need to start your window, automatically MySQL will start. Then you can go to MySQL workbench, which is a graphical user interface to use the MySQL. So let me show you a sample. So here I have already opened this MySQL site. So this one, the link which I am talking about, the URL from where you can download the community installer. So if you'll go to this download page, so here the second link, the MSI installer, you have to download for Windows 86 or 32-bit Windows or x86. So it will work in 64 also. So it will be around 450 MB of download. It will take some time depending upon your speed to install in your machine also. So I have already downloaded it and installed it. And once I have installed it, since I have not chosen to start it on the start of the Windows, that's why I need to go to this services, Windows services. If you will type in the start or the search box service, then you will end up over here. Here you can reach to this MySQL name. So here this start will be activated in your case. Since I have already started, so here stop is being shown. Let me stop it, and as well as I can start it to use. Yeah. So now you can go to this MySQL workbench. That also you can find in the start menu after installing this one, which I am talking about, MySQL workbench. Once you go to this, then you will end up in this type of window. In fact, let me close it and reopen MySQL workbench. So here you will end up this type of window, where you will click on this local instance. Root is going to be there, and you will be finding some databases or schemas already exist. Initially you will be over here. You will go to this schemas tab. Here you will find Sakila, Sys, World. So like this you will find some databases or schema. You can create your own schema or database also, as I have done over here. TestDB one I have created. If you want to create, then right click over here, then create schema. This option is visible. You can click on it and you can give that schema name. So as I have done over here, I have created a schema. Then below to it, when you expand, the tables will be visible. You can right click on the tables, create table. Then whichever columns you want to give, column names and table name, you can supply. So this way we can go for working with the MySQL. This is what I have provided, the basic. If you want to discuss more, so I'll discuss it in a separate video, but not in this video, because this is not specifically for MySQL working. I'll try to cover up as possible as the microservice part. So let us go for a microservice, where I will go for using this MySQL database. Then what does it require? If you'll go for creating a microservice by using Spring Boot, so obviously for Spring Boot development you need to have Eclipse or STS, whichever you feel like you can use it. Even if you can go for using your favorite IDE, there you have to create the Spring Boot application. I prefer to go for using Spring Boot application creation by using spring.io, or else if I am using STS, then I go for creating starter application. Then when you are creating the Spring Boot application, don't forget to include the dependency from web, JPA and MySQL. These three dependencies you have to add in the pom.xml, so that you will be able to use MySQL. You can supply the commands with the help of JPA, and as well as you can create the controller by using web. That's the REST controller we are going to create. Then next thing, when your application is ready, is built it's available in your STS, then you will see application.properties file already present in your project. In the application.properties, you have to supply the connection information, means which database you want to connect, what is going to be the username, what is going to be the password, what are going to be the DDL properties. Some information you have to supply, so that based upon those information, database connection will happen. Next comes the coding part. You can go for the fifth one, where you'll go for creating a class which will be entity that will be representing the table of the database. Next, you have to go for creating the repository, which will be an interface. That interface will be a presentation part of the database. Next, you are going to create a controller, which will be providing the endpoint or the API, so that you can accept the request or provide the response with the format of JSON, and those JSON you can view in the client, which will be which might be a browser or it might be a Postman. So how to go for using Postman, I will discuss in the later part of the video, or later videos which will be coming after this video. So let us go to the STS, where I will go for creating an application. So already I have created two applications for dealing with MySQL database. So if I'll go for using MySQL database, as I said, you need to go for using MySQL workbench. So let me go back to the MySQL workbench, where I will go for a new database altogether so that it will be easier for you. So I'll create a schema. So schema is equals database. Suppose I'll say a database as address DB. This one I will be using in the next series of videos, which I will discuss after this. So remember this part. I'm creating address DB as the schema. So schema is ready. So here you can see the tables came. So right click on the table, create table. I'll go for creating a table, or I'll leave it as it is. If I'll go for leaving the table creation part to the code, that will be possible. But let me show you once how we can go for creating the table. Suppose I'll say I'll be having the country as the table, and there I will be having the columns as so here if you'll click on the columns, so ID is going to be primary key and it's going to be auto increment. Next I can specify name as the text or varchar type of value. Okay, that much only I will use. Then if I'll click on this apply, then this table is going to be created with the two columns as I have mentioned. After the table got created, then you can go for inserting the record into it. Right click on the tables or expand the tables. Right click on the table, table named as country as I mentioned. Then here, since the first column is the primary key and auto increment, you need not to specify any data into it, just the data into the second column. That's all you have to mention, the name of the table, or sorry, name of the country. So here the India is the country present over here in this country table in the address DB database. Now if I'll go for using it in the Spring Boot microservice, so let us create a microservice for us. So here for creating the microservice, I open this Spring Toolsuit 4. I have used Spring Toolsuit. I will go for file, new, then Spring Starter Project. So here the project name, something I will go provide as maybe address service, the address microservice. So address service, I have given the name. Next, if you want to change the group name, maybe something like address, and as well as the default package name given as com.main my channel name Cyberdev, then dot address is the package name. Next, yeah, this one is very very important. Don't forget to use web as the dependency. Once the web dependency is present, now you can go for the JPA. JPA also you have to choose. Next, you have to go for using the third one is the MySQL driver you need to use. So MySQL also you need to choose. So these three dependency which I was talking about, these are now included. Next, you can go for finish. So once this address service will be ready with all this configuration, you can see here in the pom.xml, these are the inclusion of dependencies. So JPA dependency has been added, web dependency has been added, and as well as MySQL connector dependency. So these are the three main important dependencies which has been added, apart from the default dependencies which are getting added with the Spring Boot application. Now we can go for creating a class, or in fact the first step is going to be database connection properties. Database connection properties you can mention inside the application.properties. Where is this application.properties file? Now inside this resources folder you will find this application.properties, which will be empty in the beginning. That you can do by using view key and value pairs spring dot, so to save the time I'll copy from somewhere else which I have already written previously. I'll copy it from this demo. Okay, for test db1 I had written it, I copied it, then I saved it over here. So save. So here in place of test db1, so here the database which I have created recently is named as address db. So address, make sure you are not making any spelling mistake. Let me recheck it. Address db, add. Yeah, so here also I was making a mistake. Address db. So addressdb, addressdb. Yeah, and here is the username of my MySQL, then password of my MySQL of the root user, and this one is the update. I will change it to create, means I want to create the table with the help of Spring Boot application. So create value if you supply to DDL auto, then it will create the table if the table does not exist. Then I saved it. By default, the port number of the Tomcat is going to be 8080, so I am not changing the port of this Tomcat. I will keep it as it is. Now I will go for creating the class which I was talking about inside this main and Java package. So inside this com.cyberdev.address, I will go for creating a new class which will be representing the entity. So com.cyberdev.address.entities, I will give the package name. It is a good practice to keep every category of classes interfaces into different packages. So entities I will keep inside the entities package. I will name it as create a class as state. Okay, so state is the class name. So here this is not going to be an ordinary class, it is going to be an entity class. So I will give the annotation as entity. Why it is taking lot of time? Entities, come on, entity. Okay, let it be. Okay, let me, so it is bit slower. So better if I'll have the code, I will copy it from somewhere, or else it will eat our time. This does not happen. So here till now we have completed till fourth step. We have gone for adding the connection to the application.properties file, and we are in the process of creating this entity. Then we will go for creating the repository, then we will go for using controller, not constroller, sorry. So we will go for creating the REST controller. Let us see what happened to this. Something went wrong with this system. It hanged. Oh shit. Let me restart. So here I'll go for starting the STS again. So shortcut it's not getting. So let me get the shortcut from the desktop. So here is the Spring tool suite. So let me resume from the place where I had left. So here I am starting the STS again. So this one I was showing you regarding the address service. So the entities package is ready, state.java is ready. Now I'll not rely upon the STS, or in fact let me show it again. If I'll go for entities, yeah, so javax.persistententities.entities, then you have to supply the primary key information. I will be having the primary key as ID, then I will be having the name of the state, so state name, I'll keep it as state name. Then suppose I'll give it a capital also, state capital. So these three variables I have created, I will supply the setter getter methods to these three variables. So setter getter method, if you want to supply, then source getter setter, so select all, generate. So these three variables I created, then you have to supply this ID attribute, ID annotation for this. In fact, better without waiting for long time, I will copy it from somewhere. This country I had created some time back. So this two generated value, it's going to be generation type identity, that means it is going to be a primary key, and as well as it is going to be auto increment. Yeah, so this state class is ready. I have made it as entity, so it will automatically create the table. If that table does not exist, then we can go for creating the controller and as well as repository. So for controller and repository, you have to create the repository first. So I will name the repository package as repos, repository. You have to be a good name provider also to become a good programmer. So address repository, or I need state repository. State repository is the interface name, and the package name is going to be com.cyberdev.address.repository. Yeah, that's all. Then it will create an interface which needs to be a sub interface of another predefined interface, a JPA repository. So that is going to be available as a predefined one. It's going to be there inside the JPA package that you may inherit, and there you have to supply the entity name for which we have gone for creating the interface. So the state is our entity, and as well as the primary key data type. Yeah, so here this much you have to supply initially, but later stage we will see how we can add the custom methods inside our own repository. But right now we don't need any custom method. I'll keep it as it is. It has some predefined methods which we can use directly in our code. Then I'll go for creating a controller, which will be the third step in the coding part. I'll go for creating a class inside a package. I'll name it as controllers. Again, I'm telling you, you should name the packages properly also, because it's a good programmer's practice to make the other programmers understand. You should not make your code ununderstandable. It's a very unprofessional stop. So state controller I have created. Now I will make it as a REST controller. Now I will auto air the package, oh sorry, auto air the repository. The repository name I have given as state repository. Yes, I will name the variable state repository. Yes, now I will create a method which will be representing our endpoint. So I will go for returning a list of state. So I will get the list from java.util, and here I will need state as the return type or generic type of list. So get all states is the method name. I will not accept any parameter. Later stage we will see how to accept the parameter. The state I have to import. Yeah, so entities. So now inside it I have to return all states present inside the repository, or through the repository I'll find all the states. So find all is a predefined method which will return all the objects present in the states table. So this is not an ordinary method. This needs to be a request mapped method so that it can be accessed by the client. So I need to supply the path. So path is going to be, suppose states is going to be the path through which the method is going to be accessed. So that's all. If everything goes all right, let us test with the code execution. So right click on the project, run as, then Spring Boot up. So never remind. So here it is started in the 8080 port. Now let us go to the browser or Postman, whichever you feel like. I'll go to this browser, so which I had accessed the country API. Now I will go for state. Let us see. Yeah, white label error. Why it is showing white label error? Everything we have done right. Yeah, we have not done right. Here it's states. The path of the request is states, or the endpoint is states, but we cannot be accessed by using state. So here it gives a blank JSON. Why it gives a blank JSON? Because the state table which we created with the help of this code, the state table does not contain any data. Let us see where is the state table. Just let me remind you, we had this address DB. Let me refresh. So here the state table is now created. We didn't create it manually. This got created with the help of our code. So it doesn't contain any data. So we have not inserted in data. How to insert data, I will show you in the next video. But right now I will insert the data manually directly into the workbench. So state capital, I'll say suppose Bangalore, and state name is Karnataka. So apply, finish. So now let us go back to the browser. What happens if I refresh it? Here you can see state name is Karnataka, state capital is Bangalore. So that is how we can get the data from the database into the microservice and fetch it from any client. Either it can be Postman or it can be this type of thing like browser. So this is how we can go for creating a microservice. In next video we will discuss how we can go for using database more extensively and creating more number of APIs for sending the request. I'll discuss in the next video. So thanks for watching.